Every once in a while, I find something on social media that is worth reading. And sometimes even worth repeating. Recently, I found this quote, which I appreciated and I want to share with you this morning. If you can sit quietly after difficult news, if in financial downturns, you remain perfectly calm. If you can see your neighbors travel to fantastic places without a twinge of jealousy. If you can happily eat whatever is put on your plate. If you can fall asleep after a day of running around without a drink or a pill. If you can always find contentment just where you are, then you are probably a dog. Some of us here today are feeling some level of anxiety. We are often not content with the way things are in our lives and in the world. We are not able to sit quietly in the midst of our troubling circumstances, and we long for peace in our hearts. Perhaps there is some good news that we can find today in the scripture readings. Maybe there is hope for us humans, too. Our gospel reading today tells a story about a woman who is burdened. The woman is weighed down under the circumstances of her life. As we explore this gospel story, I want you to call to mind your burdens. What weighs you down? What makes you feel defeated? What are the things in your life that sap your strength and vitality? Your energy. Some of you may have trouble in your life that you just cannot overcome. Some of you perhaps feel outcast or undervalued or underappreciated at home or work or at school. Maybe you look to your future and find nothing there but a question mark. Some of you perhaps have a person in your life who is draining you. Whatever your burdens are, bring them to your mind as we explore this gospel story. In our readings for the past several weeks, Jesus has been announcing that the kingdom of God is breaking into our present reality. We've seen that both his teachings and his miracles proclaim the arrival of this kingdom. And therefore, every miracle that Jesus performs has purpose to help us understand this. Let's look at the gospel story again to discover how Jesus offers to set us free from our burdens. Now he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath, and just then there appeared a woman with a spirit that had crippled her for 18 years. She was bent over and quite unable to stand up straight. The gospel writer Luke starts us off with Jesus teaching in the synagogue, and then he presents us with this picture of a woman who we can see quite plainly. She's bent over and has been that way in a long time. If you've ever seen someone who has bent over like that, you know that it must be painful. And the fact that she's lived that way for probably at least half of her life is significant. We don't know why the woman is present in the synagogue, but we can assume that she's ready for her life to change. Now notice something else. The gospel writer attributes the woman's condition to a spirit. The gospel writer is subtly telling us that this woman has much more than a physical problem. In this case, the pain of her condition was same kind of demon possession that we hear about in other gospel stories and other healings. Rather, this kind of spirit that's troubling this bent-over woman is more like the torment that Job endured when Satan has afflicted his body. She's suffering under the spirit. Her physical limitations had weakened her spirit. The woman in the story does not call attention to herself. She does not cry out, "Lord Jesus Christ, have mercy on me," as other people do that are healed. Instead, Jesus just notices this woman who's bent over, and he calls her to him. Jesus frees her from her bondage, from her evil spirit. He demonstrates his authority over the spiritual realm. He announces that his kingdom has come. But this is not just an ordinary healing story. It takes place on the Sabbath in the synagogue, and the leader of the synagogue is indignant. And the synagogue leader reacts to what Jesus does in a very interesting way. He does not address Jesus directly, but turns to the crowd and tells them he doesn't like what Jesus has done. He doesn't refute directly what Jesus has done, but he says, "Here is my teaching. Here is my understanding of what God wants from us." What we see is a battle of two authorities. The synagogue leader desperately wants to hold on to his control by binding the people to his narrow interpretation of the law. And Jesus, on the other hand, proclaims freedom. Freedom to follow the intent of the law. We know that Jesus cares about the Sabbath, that Jesus thinks honoring the Sabbath is important. In other places, Jesus says that we need to do good on the Sabbath. When there is a need, it's okay to do something good for others on the Sabbath day. So what does this healing have to do with us? What relevance does this woman's healing have to do with our burdens, the things that make us weary, toilsome, and drab? Where is Christ's victory for us? We all have burdens and hardships and limitations. It's just a part of life. Every mature person realizes that life is full of challenges. Our faith is not a guarantee against hardship, but Jesus offers us a way through it. In Matthew chapter 11, we hear these very familiar words, "Come to me, all you that are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light." In other words, following Jesus makes our burdens lighter. In right one version of our worship, we hear that familiar scripture verse, those scripture verses each week after we confess our sins. In the old 1928 Book of Common Prayer that's very near and dear to many of you, these verses of Scripture are introduced each week in worship with this phrase, "Hear what comfortable words our Savior Christ saith unto all who truly turn to Him. Come to me, all you who are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest." What hope does Jesus offer here to us? The woman in the story is freed from her physical afflictions, but we are still bent over with our burdens. We live every day with the painful fact that life is difficult. Where is our victory? Where is our freedom? We have been set free, but we don't always feel feel like we are free. In one sense, we know that freedom will be fully attained in the new heaven and the new earth. Christ, through his death and resurrection and ascension, will lift our burdens. We know that. One day, we will enjoy the fullness of abundant life in him in that great and glorious day, in that perfect place where there is no pain or grief or sorrow. But that freedom that Jesus brings also works for us right here and now. Jesus moves us and frees us to be more than our burdens. So many people let their burdens define them, and they are bound to those definitions. In effect, their lives become centered around their limitations, and it shapes their whole identity. I have thoroughly enjoyed watching the Olympics these last few days on television, and I've even enjoyed watching some of the commercials. There's a commercial about the upcoming Paralympics that always catches my attention. A young woman who's running with great speed while wearing a prosthetic leg. It's amazing. I just stare at the screen every time I see it. It inspires me. If she can do that, what can I do? We should not let our limitations define us. Jesus says it doesn't have to be that way. In Christ, we have a new identity. We're not just someone struggling to get through this life. Now, I'm not talking about denial of our problems, but I'm suggesting that we find a way in Christ to see our way through them. A spirit of heaviness can take hold of us and weigh us down, but we don't have to live that way. We are children God. It is quite significant that Jesus, when he's speaking to the leader of the synagogue in the gospel story today, calls the woman a daughter of Abraham. This bent over woman has an identity that is greater than her burdens. It is the identity that gave her hope for 18 years of suffering. And that was the identity of being a child of her heavenly Father, being special to God, being the apple of God's eye. Our burdens don't define the limit of who we are. I have seen some real-life examples of people that have been set free from their burdens, even when the burden is still there. In another parish where I served, I saw a wonderful example of this week after week. There was a dear woman in our congregation who suffered with chronic pain and several illnesses in her life. I visited her a number of times in the hospital over the years. I helped her in and out of her wheelchair. I helped her move slowly through doorways with her walker. Yet she had one of the most pleasant demeanors of anyone that I have ever met. She was not just pleasant, she was joyful. In fact, I often joked about her among people in the congregation saying that she was our one-person welcoming committee at the church. If she ever saw someone visiting our church, she was determined to get to them, to greet them, to share her joy with them, make them feel welcome. That was one of her ministries. She did not let her limitations define her. She always looked to her strength, which was her faith in Jesus Christ. She lived a life that was set free. Now we all know that sometimes our troubles in life, our burdens, can make us bitter. I remember one time years ago, in that same parish, in a Sunday school class, we were talking about growing old and aging and all the issues we have to deal with as our life progressed, and we all, in that classroom, voiced our desire to be happy in our old age, to live lives of contentment. We cited examples of people we knew who were enjoying their old age despite the many challenges they faced. We all, in fact, said we wanted to be just like this woman in the story that I told you about who was so joyful. We wanted to be like her, pleasant, joyful, in the midst of our circumstances. Another one of my good friends, Kitty, who was in that Sunday school class that day, shared with us a bit of wisdom. She said in her wonderful southern accent, "Y'all, if you want to have a pleasant disposition when you get old, well, you have to start being that way now." Kidding was right. It is about attitude or determination. Or maybe it's just about realizing what we already have. We have been set free to live each day as children of God with all the promises that are included in that. When the woman in the gospel story was freed, she stood up and began praising God. When Jesus put the synagogue leader in his place, the entire crowd began rejoicing. We can rejoice too, even in the midst of our troubles and burdens. We still remember Father Nick's signature dismissal, don't we? Life is short. Make of it what you can. Don't live bent over under the weight of your burdens. Look up to God, the source of your strength. Don't let your problems define you. Realize that you have been set free already. Put your whole trust